Hello, welcome. In today's video, we're finally bringing the highly requested tier list for Android that you've all been asking for. However, since a full analysis of all available emulators for Android would take quite some time, as I don't know all of them, and new ones are constantly emerging, today, we'll focus on the platforms you enjoy the most. I've tested most of the popular emulators for the Nintendo 3DS and Nintendo Switch, and that's what we'll be checking out now. First, let's establish a few rules. I want to make it clear that I'm not a fan of any specific project, and my opinion here will be totally impartial. If you have a different opinion, feel free to discuss it politely in the comments. I'll read and try to respond to most of them. Unlike the Windows version tier list, here we'll be evaluating the performance and accuracy of the emulators. If a project is outdated or has obsolete features, that will be considered, but as a secondary criterion. The tier list will be divided into two parts, one for the Nintendo 3DS and another for the Nintendo Switch. My final opinion will be available as images in the video description, so you can download and use them as a guide if you wish. The hardware used for recording was a ROG Phone 6 with 8 GB of RAM and a Snapdragon 8 Plus Gen 1 GPU. To ensure the results weren't affected by capture software, I used an external capture card. This way, the results are accurate, without any speed up or slowdown due to the recording process. Now, starting with the Nintendo 3DS, the internal resolution used during testing was 4x, the maximum allowed by Citra MMJ, and all the projects were run using the Vulkan API. Among the emulators I tested, I didn't find any that were truly bad, they are all good or great. So, we'll have just two tiers to keep it simple. Remember, the main criterion is still performance. All the gameplay shown here was captured directly from the respective projects. Starting with the latest version of Citra Nightly 2104, this version of the emulator went a long time without significant updates, as the team focused on Yuzu, leaving Citra behind. Fortunately, in the last few months before the project ended, the emulator received support for the Vulkan API and custom drivers for Adreno GPUs. If you're still using this version, know that there are better options available today, but if it's meeting your needs, there's no rush to switch. However, since this project won't receive any more updates or improvements, we'll place it in the good tier. The second emulator we'll evaluate is PabloMK7's Fork. For those unfamiliar, Pablo was an official developer for Citra, and he decided to continue the project after the official development ended. Unlike Citra Nightly, Pablo continues to improve his fork, fixing bugs and implementing improvements. If you're looking for a more accurate and updated version of the original Citra, this is the one for you. However, it's important to remember that other emulators we'll cover have performance hacks that can be useful. Although Pablo's fork has the most accuracy, our main criterion here is performance, so it will be placed in the good tier but ahead of the official Citra. Now, let's talk about the community favorite, Citra MMJ, and the version we tested was the Antutu. For those who don't know, the Antutu trick makes Android treat the emulator like a benchmark, unlocking more resources, which boosts performance but also increases the device's temperature. This version went a while without updates, but recently received an improvement. However, its interface is the most limited, and the menu has fewer options compared to other projects. Despite that, its performance is the best, with fast shader compilation, reducing stutters during gameplay. However, its accuracy is the lowest. Because of its performance, it deserves to be in the amazing tier, but the negative points, such as the interface and constant control layout configuration, place it in the good tier. Now, let's move on to Mandarine, previously known as Citra Enhanced or Lemonade. This project has gone through several name changes, which caused some confusion, and was also involved in controversies with PabloMK7. Despite this, Mandarine has implemented various useful features and performance hacks, providing better performance than the official Citra and PabloMK7's fork, but slightly behind Citra MMJ. The only downside of Mandarine is the shader compilation, which is slightly worse than the others. Considering performance is our main criterion, Mandarine will be the first in the amazing tier. Finally, we have Line 3DS, which started modestly as a Citra fork with few improvements but, over the months, has implemented several functionalities and hacks from Citra MMJ, focusing on more modest devices. Line 3DS has evolved significantly, gaining an intuitive interface and solid performance. In the shader compilation tests, it came in second, only behind Citra MMJ. Perhaps if it adopted the Antutu trick, its performance could match that of Citra MMJ. Due to its modern features and good performance, Line 3DS will also be placed in the amazing tier. In conclusion, while Citra MMJ offers the best performance, its lack of recent features, such as native support for USB games and the difficulty in enabling basic options, made it rank in the good tier. However, if performance is your priority, this is still the best choice. For those looking for a balance between accuracy and performance, Line 3 DS or Mandarine are good options. If accuracy is your focus, PabloMK7's fork is ideal. As for the official Citra, which has been discontinued, there's no longer any reason to use it. That's the final conclusion of our tier list for Nintendo 3DS emulators for Android. Now, before we dive into our Nintendo Switch emulator tier list, don't forget to leave a like if you enjoy this kind of content. And if this is your first time on the channel, consider subscribing to stay updated with the latest news in the world of emulation. Our Switch emulator tier list will be slightly different. We'll divide the projects into Tier S and Tier A for the good and great emulators. However, we'll also have a category for questionable projects that don't inspire any confidence and may even be suspected of being viruses, having obscure origins, or not clearly revealing what's in their code. Lastly, we'll include emulators that are terrible, where most games are in an unplayable state. The main criterion will still be performance. However, if there's a serious issue in another area, such as reliability or security, the emulator may lose points and drop in the list, as we saw earlier with Citra MMJ in the 3DS list. All gameplays, except those from Torzu, were recorded in the tested emulators. Now, let's get to it, and we'll start with the worst-case scenario. Before showing any gameplay, let's talk about EGNS. When installing EGNS, it requests several suspicious permissions, including precise and approximate location, access to nearby devices, notifications, photos, videos, music, and audio from your device. Additionally, to access the emulator, you need to create a login and password, and it requires a folder with specific files provided by the emulator itself, unlike others that only accept firmware and keys. This is already a major red flag, especially since it is an app developed in China. EGNS, currently in its version 4 available on the Play Store, is essentially a copy of the early versions of Yuzu NC but with several questionable additions that do not improve the user experience. One of the major issues is the constant display of ads. Every time you switch games or try to restart the emulator, you are forced to watch several ads, making the experience frustrating. In terms of performance and accuracy, it is not the worst on the list but comes close. Practically nothing works properly, and the ads make everything even more unbearable. If you have this emulator on your system, I strongly recommend uninstalling it immediately. Although it can run some games, EGNS goes into the doubtful tier. Stay away from EGNS. Now let's look at Yuzu. I tested the latest development version available, which is not on the Play Store. Yuzu already runs many games, and I've made videos showing over 150 playable games. However, it requires significant graphics processing power and nearly 12GB of RAM to run the best titles. Despite this, there are other emulators on this list that outperform Yuzu in terms of performance and optimizations, such as RAM leak fixes and improvements for newer games like Paper Mario and Princess Peach's game. If the game you are playing runs well on Yuzu, you can continue using it, but if this is your first time installing, there are better alternatives. Thus, it is placed in Tier A. Next is Uzuy. I tested the in-dev version, and despite controversies involving the Sudachi developer, I can assure you that the project is real and trustworthy, with no viruses. Yuzuy's performance is excellent, although some games run on Sudachi and not on Yuzuy, and vice versa. A significant feature is the use of the Antutu trick, which boosts performance but is optional. Yuzuy also has a memory manager, offering modes that can balance RAM usage or use all available memory aggressively. This feature is unprecedented in Switch emulators and shows how Yuzuy is at the forefront of innovations. Additionally, the project recently opened its code, gaining even more credibility. With decent accuracy and exceptional performance, it will be the first emulator to enter Tier S. Now let's talk about Sudachi. The developer of this project is one of the most experienced in the Switch emulation scene, but updates take a while, usually between 1 to 2 months. This is because Sudachi is developed by a single person. Even so, it was the first to introduce a significant reduction in RAM usage and fix memory leaks, something Yuzu still struggles with. When a new game is released, Sudachi is the first to receive fixes, with other projects incorporating the improvements later. It is a comprehensive and refined emulator, but its lack of frequent updates might deter those wanting to play the latest titles. Therefore, it is placed in Tier A. let's discuss Torzu. This emulator emerged around the same time as Sudachi, surrounded by controversy for initially being developed on the deep web to avoid problems with Nintendo. When Torzu was released on GitHub as a rebrand of Yuzu, many users reported bugs that were fixed. But the developer made it clear that they did not intend to take the project seriously or create expectations in the community. Now, Torzu is developed privately on a personal blog, and trusting an emulator that originated from the deep web with unavailable code can be risky. In tests, Torzu did not show any difference from the latest version of Yuzu, but while Yuzu is a reliable project, Torzu is an unknown. Hence, it also falls into the doubtful tier. Pine emerged with the proposal of being the successor to Skyline, but it actually seems to be just a rebrand. I tested various 3D games, from the simplest to the most complex, and none worked as they should. The latest version was released in July, and the last developer feedback was over 2 months ago. Since then, user-reported issues have not even been responded to. This leads me to believe that the project has been abandoned. Moreover, no one else on YouTube is talking about it anymore. My personal experience with Pine was terrible. Only a Metroidvania with 2D graphics that was on my USB drive managed to run. Therefore, it goes into the unplayable tier, as we have much better options available. Now, about Skyline. It was the first project to attempt to bring the Nintendo Switch experience to Android, but the developers abandoned the project midway out of fear of facing a lawsuit from Nintendo. Even in its latest release version, Skyline is quite poor, both in terms of available features and compatibility list. You will hardly manage to run anything with decent resolution, and even the simplest games will perform poorly, with very low FPS and lots of graphical glitches. For this reason, it also goes into the unplayable tier, alongside Pine. And so we conclude our list of Nintendo Switch emulators for Android. There are other emulators, like CU, Nozomi, and a few others, but they are abandoned projects or never completed, so it's not worth mentioning them. I hope you enjoyed the video. Remember that this analysis is based on my current personal experience. I didn't use any old gameplay footage, and all content was captured 2 days before posting this video. Thanks for watching, and see you in the next video.